He was born in Ramallah, in the West Bank, a breeding ground for hatred and acts of terror against Israel and the West. He was reared in the ways of radical Islam as preached by Hamas, the most notorious of terrorist organizations in the world today. He participated in uprisings against Israel and was being groomed to assume the leadership of Hamas's political wing. He is Mosab Hassan Yousef, son of the infamous Sheikh Hassan Yousef, one of the founding members and most prominent leaders of Hamas.
I loved Hamas because I loved my father. Your father is everything for you as a child. And you think that he's the best, he's the strongest, he's your king. When there is an attack in Israel, I used to celebrate.
But then it all changed. In 1996, as Israel was being rocked by a series of suicide bombings, Mosab came face to face with Israeli soldiers and soon found himself in an Israeli prison.
In any Israeli jail, Hamas has a mini government inside that jail, and they're very, very organized.
The brutality of his people against their own began to open Yousef's eyes to the big lie, a lie he could no longer go on living.
They tortured and they killed their own people. They put noodles under their fingernails. They didn't allow them to sleep for weeks continuously. They just keep woking them up, put them in a very difficult positions. Burning their bodies by burning piece of plastic. It doesn't happen without their knowledge, for sure. Haniya, my father, everybody in Hamas leadership responsible for any decision that Hamas makes.
Putting himself in mortal danger, Yousef began working covertly to help the state of Israel. The information he supplied is said to have prevented dozens of suicide attacks and the assassinations of many Israelis. Fleeing for his life, Yousef came to America, where he has been courageously and passionately speaking out, telling his story and making the case for who the true enemies of the Palestinian people are.
I had to do this. I had to do this because this is going to change so many people's lives.
His book, Son of Hamas, reveals new information about the world's most dangerous terrorist organization and unveils the truth about his own role.
If I go back to any Arab country, I would be executed regarding to any Arab and Muslim country law.
How many times have you ever heard an agent of Shin Bet, the Israeli Secret Service, go public? This is a man who was Mosab Hassan's handler because he believes Mosab Hassan must be supported now because a lot of people owe their lives to Hassan.
He saved Americans, he saved Jews, he saved Palestinians, he saved human beings.
Based on Ben Yitzchak's statements, Hassan was granted permanent asylum in the United States. On Monday evening, February 21st, Mosab Hassan Yousef will be appearing live at the Hyatt Westlake Plaza Hotel for an unforgettable encounter hosted by Chabad of the Conejo. This is a story you will not want to miss, a chilling message you will not soon forget.
I believe that fighting terrorism starts with fighting its ideology. And this is my duty now, and I understand the importance of it. I will keep going.
My name is Rabbi Moshe Brisky. I am the executive director of Chabad of the Conejo and the Conejo Jewish Academy. The Academy is an adult education institute that offers each and every individual and family an opportunity to learn more about their heritage, their history, our practices, and our traditions. Our doors are open to all, And I invite you to take some of the literature home with you that you have found on your seats this evening. Take advantage of what is being offered to you in your community. There was a big ship. The ship was sailing calmly in the ocean, and suddenly in the dark of night, the ship commander saw lights coming straight at him. Alarmed, he quickly ordered, "Change course. Shift directions 30 degrees south." The response came back, "No, shipmaster, you shift 30 degrees north." The ship commander was furious. "Do you realize to whom you are talking? This is Captain MacArthur, master of the seas. You shift 30 degrees south immediately." The response came right back, "I don't care who you are, you better shift 30 degrees north." The captain shouted right back, "How dare you? This is Captain MacArthur. This is a 200-ton destroyer. Get out of the way for your own safety immediately." Comes the response, "I don't care who you are or what you're driving. This is the light tower you're talking to, and you better move real fast." These are difficult times. Our world is in turmoil. The Middle East is exploding before our eyes. The world is shaking. Oil controls our world economy, so events in the Middle East affect each and every single human being on the face of the planet. And there in the middle of this quite dangerous neighborhood sits our promised land, the Holy Land of Israel. Difficult times indeed. And the fear of what tomorrow could bring, fear of future attacks, many nuclear weapons, chemical weapons, war in the Middle East, indeed, the world is shaking. And it is in these times, especially in these times, that we need those who are light towers, those who stand up, speak the truth, with courage, with bravery, with determination. We need this leadership all over. We need this leadership in government, in community, from our religious institutions, in the world of public relations, in the world of media. In just a moment, one such light tower will come to the stage. A man born in Ramallah, slightly different than Agoura Hills in Westlake Village. A man who has shown us the definition of heroism, bravery, courage, and sacrifice. I'd like to say to Mosab that this room is very crowded this evening. Many came to hear what you have to say about your life story, about your decision to spy for Israel, about the Middle East. But I believe at the same time, many here came to show our gratitude and our appreciation to you for being that light tower. On behalf of all of us in this room, on behalf of Jewish people throughout the entire world, on behalf of the so many Christians that are here with us tonight, on behalf of people of all faiths throughout the world that seek freedom and truth, I bless you that God should watch over you and protect you and grant you long life, good health, happiness and prosperity, and tremendous success in your most vital endeavors. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming to the stage Mr. Mosab Hassan Yousef. As our moderator this evening, we welcome the President of the Rabbinical Council of Orange County and Long Beach, He serves on the board of the Jewish Federation of Orange County and is very active in local and national Jewish affairs. I welcome Rabbi David Eliezeri, who would like to make a presentation to our guest speaker. Please join me in welcoming to the podium, representing California's 27th district in the United States House of Representatives, one of Israel's staunchest supporters in the House. Please welcome Congressman Brad Sherman.
Good to see you again.
Hello, I'm Brad Sherman from America's best name city, Sherman Oaks. I'm in my 15th year on the Foreign Affairs Committee, where I served as chair and now ranking member of the Subcommittee on Terrorism and Nonproliferation. Rabbi Brisky, it's a pleasure to be with you again here in the Conejo. I want to introduce Aubrey Farkas of my office, who works in our constituent service program and is a little shy, but stand up there. And just describe that program for just a second. Imagine a federal agency makes a mistake. It could happen. You call Aubrey, she'll work very hard, she solves your problem, and then I take the credit. It's an outstanding system. Now, I only have about an hour and a half of presentation here. But they've told me to keep it to 4 or 5 minutes. If you'd like more information about what I'm doing in Congress or our efforts to impose additional sanctions on Iran, et cetera, just drop me a line at congressmanbradsherman@gmail.com, and I'll keep you informed on all the things that I don't have time to say here this evening. We're here to hear from an extraordinary man, a man of great courage, of great conviction. And I know you're going to hear a very interesting presentation, because I shared the podium with Mosab about a year ago at the Endowment for Middle East Truth in Washington, D.C. And there I learned two things. One is a better understanding of Hamas, which is so important now because Hamas is perhaps the offspring of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt. And as we look at the tumult in the Arab world, we see in Egypt where there are those who seem to follow Google, those who follow Mubarak or Mubarakism without Mubarak present, and those who follow the Brotherhood. And unless the army works closely with those who favor democracy, we could see the army form an alliance with the Brotherhood, or try to go it alone and force those who want democracy to perhaps turn to the Brotherhood in an anti-regime alliance. So understanding Hamas is important, not just in terms of understanding one organization, but understanding a whole group of organizations that confront Israel. As we saw with the revolutions in France in the 1700s, or Russia in 1917, or Iran in the 1970s, often the autocrat is dislodged by those who favor democracy. But then within a few months, those who favor democracy are pushed aside by those who favor violence, those who are hardcore and organized, whether it be Kerensky being displaced by Lenin, or whether it be Ashakpour Bakhtiar displaced by Khomeini. The second thing I learned from hearing our guest when he spoke in Washington is just how absurd the U.S. government can be. Because at that time, he was seeking asylum in the United States for obvious reasons. And believe it or not, the Department of Homeland Security was not granting that asylum on the theory that he had too many connections with a terrorist organization called Hamas. Yes, this is your government and mine. Many of us spoke out as to how absurd it was and how this man of courage so much deserved asylum here in the United States. Then Gordon Ben Itzhak, who had been his handler at Shin Bet, revealed his own identity in order to testify for Mr. Yousef. And eventually, as I understand it, the immigration judge reached the right conclusion. So now I have an opportunity to welcome you not as a man seeking asylum, but a man who has found asylum, has found a new home. And one of the things that I get to do as a member of Congress is to arrange to get one of the flags that's flown over the Capitol in Washington, D.C., and give it to someone who makes us proud to be Americans. I'd like to give you this flag. Now, Rabbi Brisky, we're people of faith, but I sense some skepticism in the back of the room. Some are wondering how you can know that that flag actually flew over the Capitol. They've seen me at Costco. They sell flags there. Well, folks, if you can't trust your local congressman, then it's perhaps it's wise that I can also give you a certificate of authenticity to restore faith to the skeptics.
Thank you very much.
Mosab Hassan Yousef, you are a hero we can all be proud of. Thank you for being here.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much, Congressman Sherman. I'm a friend of Rabbi Brisky from Orange County, the remote wilds of, I think Agoura was far out, you know what I mean? A few months ago, Mosab came to visit our Chabad Center in Yorba Linda, in the land of so-called gracious living, which the most exciting thing that happens is the grass may grow the wrong color. And it was the first time he came to a synagogue. And as I said then, you know, how do you fill a shul when it's not Rosh Hashanah Kippur? Just bring a guy from Hamas that fills up the synagogue. But we had a wonderful encounter, and Rabbi Brisky asked me to come back tonight. And if we do well, we're going to be booked at the Wynn Hotel in Vegas on a regular basis. It'll be a nightly 8 o'clock show. We'll be off on Friday, Saturday, and Sundays. Mosab has a really interesting story. And we're going to talk a little bit later about some contemporary events and some the things which are issues which are standing in front of us historically. But it's a long way. Those of you who have ever been in the West Bank, it's a different kind of life than we live here in California. And it's a long way from the village of Berlin, if I'm correct, and Ramallah, all the way to Agoura. It was a little closer to Yorba Linda, but Agoura is a little further out. But it's a long way. And Mosab, why don't you tell us a little bit about, well, let me ask you this, because we didn't talk about this last time. How was it growing up as a child in this kind of community? Did you feel you had the freedom to be a child, or you felt depressed? What was the sense of your childhood?
Well, first of all, it's nice to meet you again.
Yeah.
Second, Erev Tov to everybody, and Masal Khair to my friends here with the Palestinian
Kofiyas. No,
good evening, everybody. Growing up as a Palestinian child is not the easiest thing for a child. It's not the best environment for a child to grow up. Occupation, from one hand, persecution, violence. I personally used to live next to a cemetery, and I witnessed lots of killing, lots of bloodshed, and I was persecuted both from the Israeli settlers and from my own people. And we paid a very high price as a family, more than any Palestinian family. As a child and as a person sitting in this seat, many people who think that they are pro-Palestinians, they didn't pay a small portion of the price that I paid for Palestine. And I love my people. I spend more time than any one of them in Israeli prisons. And I had to pay a very high price for the cause of Palestine. And I know that our problem is the occupation for one reason, because we hang all our problems on the occupation. And we never had the courage to face our responsibility and say, we screwed up as Palestinians. Unfortunately, we keep to blame Israel, America, and hate, and spread the message of hate. This is, of course, normal. Why? Because people grow up in that environment facing all type of aggression, and they only learn how to hate. And as a child, I learned only how to hate. I didn't have to learn it in a school. I learned it through my experience in life. And this is the time that people need to move on and have the courage to look for the future and forget about the past and keep stuck in the past.
You know, 2 years ago there was a terrorist attack in Mumbai. And many of you know what happened there. And in the terrorist attack, maybe I'm being a little unfair with this, but nevertheless, this is something that struck me very strongly. Our center, our synagogue, was attacked in Mumbai, and 5 people were killed, including Rabbi Gabriel Noya Heilsberg and his wife Rivka. And at the cemetery in Israel afterwards, a very close friend of Rabbi Brisky and myself spoke. And he said, we're not going to answer with AK-47s, and we're not going to answer with grenades. We're going to let governments do what they have to do. What we're going to do is to dedicate ourselves to do more goodness in the memory of these people that passed away. And let's be very honest, Chabad is a pretty well-organized group of campers. If we decided to sneak a few guys into Pakistan and look for the guys who made the trouble, we probably could do it. Everybody knows we're pretty resourceful people. But that's not our style. But what's interesting here is you're talking, it's a tragedy for the Palestinian people. Because this, instead of confronting the real issues, and trying to find some kind of common ground and some way to live at peace together with the Israelis and with the Jews, it seems like this culture of hatred, which seems to go back a long way, is ultimately going to be the most defeating factor to their lives.
Okay, let me tell you why I hated Israel and I hated the Jews when I was a child. I had ideological reasons, and this is the most important dimension of this conflict, that people don't want to talk about. And they keep saying, this is politically correct and this is politically incorrect. The God of Muslims hates the Jews. He does not like them. His prophet does not like them. His prophet killed and raped Safiya and her entire family, her entire tribe, the Jews of Khaybar, for no reason but not to give him the treasure to fund his campaigns against Persia. So if the prophet hates the Jewish nation, and if his God hates them as well, why do we only blame Muslims? And nobody wants to talk about this ideological dimension of the conflict. Second, political reasons. Everybody is teaching the new generation that your problem is Israel. While they have better education than any Arab country, they have better health care than any Arab country, and they are the most educated Arab nation.
Are you speaking about Israeli Arabs?
I'm speaking about Israeli Arabs, that they will never give up their citizenship and go live in any Arab country.
But they're still not happy about
it. And also I'm talking about the Palestinians from the West Bank. They are the most educated people among all the Arab nations. Why is that? Our problem, Palestinians, that we focused and all our focus all the time to destroy Israel, not to build a Palestinian state. And we are sending our children to death on a daily basis, and we are happy about it. In fact, we are proud about it. We think about a bunch of stones in Jerusalem, and we don't care about the entire generation and the generations to come. And this is why I had to stand, not because I hate my people, I love my people. I'm not here to promote for Israel. I don't work for Israel. I don't work for America. I love my people, and I want what's best for them, but they have to stand for the truth, first of all.
So the ultimate tragedy is for the Palestinian child.
Yes, and who's getting all the benefits from this conflict? Their leaders. And they keep lying and spreading the lies while people are used as fuel for this crazy conflict. Israel is a reality. And in fact, Israel does not hate. I worked for the Israeli Shin Bet 10 years, and I was not discovered. I exposed myself. Why? Because I've seen that our enemy is not Israel by any chance. We are the enemies of ourselves.
Is there Palestinians on the West Bank who agree with you but may be fearful to express their point of view?
Everybody is afraid of three main factors in the Middle East: shame, guilt, and fear. Nobody wants to bring disappointment for his parents or for her parents, and nobody wants to be considered as collaborator with Israel or the West. Even if they go and clap for suicide bomber who just killed himself and congratulate his mother. This is what Palestinians do after a suicide bomber kill himself and kill many innocent people.
I was in Gaza one day. The bus turned right and I turned left. A suicide bomber blew up the bus. I spent a day there. I wrote about it in the LA Times at the time. This was some years ago. This was right after Oslo. What shocked me most, I was on the site of the suicide bombing in Gaza for maybe 6-7 hours. After a while, they let some buses come by with Palestinians on the side of the road. This is on the main Gaza north-south freeway highway. And it was like they were celebrating the death of the Jews like it was Mardi Gras in New Orleans. I was astonished. I was shocked. There was a sense of joy that people were killed. Now, in Jewish tradition, we're told that even if our enemy, God forbid, gets killed, we're not supposed to celebrate the death of somebody because that person is a human being and has human dignity. I was not in love with Yasser Arafat. The day he died, I didn't throw a party. I was relieved. Deep down, I wanted to throw a party, but Judaism told me you don't throw a party when a human being is killed.
Yeah.
So this culture is really a tragedy.
You know, it's justified by the highest authority of that society, who's like their God. This is the problem. If their God is okay, it's a way of worship.
So how do we change it? If you are saying what you're saying is true, then the hope for any sense of a combination between Jews and Arabs in the Holy Land becomes almost impossible.
Yeah. First of all, let me give, maybe some people here even don't know where I'm coming from.
Yeah, we need to talk about the little bit where he came from.
I was born as a Muslim for one of the founders of the Muslim Brotherhood and one of the founders of Hamas movement, Sheikh Hassan Yousef, my dad that I love and admire. He's my best example among all men. He's in an Israeli prison now. I love him and I pray for him every day. My dad is one of the founders of Hamas organization, the terrorist organization that is responsible for the death of many Israelis, Palestinians, and Americans. I grew up in that environment. I studied the Sharia law, and I memorized a huge portion of the Quran. I studied Muhammad's journey, and I grew up disciplined to every command of the God of the Quran, more than most Muslims. When I was called Mosab in the 1970s, I was the only Mosab in the entire West Bank. Mosab was one of most important Muhammad's followers. My mother used to teach me about him. He was the first Islamic ambassador. Why he was different than all Muhammad's followers? Because he was from a royal family and he was rich, unlike most Muhammad's followers. And my mother used to tell me, we named you Mus'ab 10 years before you were born because we have expectations from you. This is what Mus'ab did. His mother told him, if you don't leave Muhammad's message and come back to the religion of your fathers, I am going to fast and strike till I die. And he answered her in a very special way, saying, if you have 7 souls and you lose all of them one after another, I am not going to leave Muhammad's message. This is how he was dedicated to Muhammad's message. And my mother, this is the type of stories that I grew up listening to and learning, because my family had huge expectations from me. And I personally paid a very high price for the cause of Islam, as I said. I was kidnapped when I was 9 years old by the Israeli settlers. I never miss a Fajr, which is like dawn prayer, while most Muslims miss that prayer. And I was willing to die for the glory of Allah. I was willing to do that. At the age of 17, I bought guns. I was member of Hamas, and I was member of president of the Islamic student movement. And I decided to take revenge from Israel for all the wrong reasons. Not because some of them are not true. Not because they are not arrested my father 16 times while every father is sitting with his family. Just spreading the message of hate in comfort, and my father and my entire family still paying the price till today. They can sit here in America, enjoy liberty, and spread the message of hate while my family is paying the price back there. My family matters to me more than all their propaganda and their kufiyas. I paid a very high price for Islam, and I know what Islam is all about. I am in a position to put Islam on the scale and judge it, because I know what Islam is all about. I know the real nature of it. I know its prophet. I know its Quran. I know its God. I know its false religion. And the best way for my people, the best way for them to be liberated from their God. We have natural resources. We have human resources. We have everything, and we are behind. Why are we behind? Because America hates us? What a lie. Because Israel hates us and wants to destroy us? This is even a bigger lie. Israel has the right to that land. It's a historic right. We cannot change history. If we are ignorant, if the majority of people are ignorant, the best way to educate them so they can start to understand that this is a reality, we have to deal with it. So this is where I'm coming from. I know that this is a very intense, and I'm sorry, I don't mean to be very emotional, but I mean to deliver the message no matter the cost is.
Mosab, when you got the guns and you wanted to kill the Israelis, that really led to your own imprisonment and your own going to jail. Maybe you can tell us a little bit about what happened.
Well, I was arrested in 1996 by Israeli Shin Bet.
Shin Bet, for those who don't know, is Shirutei Bitachon, which is like the Israeli Secret Service, the internal police.
And I was tortured for 3 months in an underground facility. Most of the torture was mental torture. I wasn't allowed to sleep for a long time. And I was beaten by Israeli soldiers all the way to that facility, almost to death. But that was not an Israeli governmental policy. On both sides, you will find people who are full of hate. And they knew that I was the son of a top Hamas leader, and they thought maybe this is a great opportunity to take revenge for all our friends who were killed or were injured. And it was more of an individual initiative than it's a governmental one. 3 months, it was a very difficult condition. And even I hated the Jewish people, I hated the Israelis more and more. During that time, an Israeli officer came into the office. He was very kind, and he asked me simply to work for the Israeli Shin Bet, the Israeli FBI. I'm looking and thinking and says, like, what's the matter with this idiot? They arrested my father. They killed my people. They took our land. And they tortured me. They've been torturing me for the last few months, and now he's asking me to work for Israel.
Did he intimidate you or did he just ask you?
No intimidation. It was just a friendly conversation.
No, brought him a falafel and says work for Israel.
One thing about the Israeli Shin Bet, that they are willing to work with anybody if he's willing to bring information to the Shin Bet. So it was a friendly conversation, and I told him I need to think about that. I had in mind to infiltrate the Shin Bet. No money, no offer on earth would attract me.
So you wanted to outsmart them and be a double agent?
That was the goal that I had in mind. And that was the only goal that I had in mind. After that, I was transferred to Israeli prison. Why? Because they told me you have to go to prison for a short time in order to have a cover. If you are released, people are going to get suspicious about you. I agreed. I go to Israeli prison that was controlled by Hamas from inside. We're talking about 2,000 prisoners. Hamas members could communicate with each other. They had a mini government inside.
So the Hamas organized the prison. This was in Megiddo?
It was Megiddo. The prison was under the Israeli administration, of course. But Hamas, because most prisoners are not considered, even by Israel, as criminal prisoners.
They're political prisoners.
They're political prisoners.
Security prisoners.
Exactly. So they feel that they have the right to communicate, and they have the right to have their own movement inside the prison. And the Israeli administration is not against that. It gives them that freedom.
Was Hamas the only group in the prison, or one of a few?
It was the majority. There was Fatah and other organizations.
And how did the Fatah and Hamas, they were really at odds with each other, or were they?
During that time in 1996, Fatah was minority in prison, and Hamas was the majority based on the peace accords with Israel, because Fatah was considered the peaceful party, so not many members stayed in prison during that time. Mm-hmm. But Hamas members, of course, were held in Israeli and Palestinian Authority jails. What I discovered during that time, after next day when I arrived, lots of torture was taking place. People were screaming all night long. And I was asking, what's going on? And nobody would answer. Till I discovered that it was torture from the Hamas security wing against other Hamas members. What's the problem? Why are you torturing people? The problem that they had suspicion that those people had a relationship with the Israeli Shin Bet. So I thought, I'm in big trouble, it seems.
Did the Israelis know about the torture going on, or it was hidden from them?
Of course they knew about the torture.
But they stepped back.
It was a very complicated story. They used to smuggle prisoners from section to section. So the Israeli administration would come into a section and search, make sure that everybody is okay. We have 100 number of prisoners, mm-hmm. So everybody was there. But Hamas cut the fence and used to smuggle the ones who were under the torture to the other sections.
So they wouldn't be
and
aware.
And replace them with other prisoners. So the administration is hearing people screaming all night long, but they don't know how to rescue them, simply. Mm-hmm. And honestly, is it the responsibility of the Israeli administration to educate Hamas morals? How to deal or treat their people like human beings? So I was shocked by that, and I said, okay, well, I want to try my chances and see. Since I am in a relationship with the Israeli Shin Bet, let's see what the Hamas security wing are going to say. So I went to them and I said, this is 1, 2, 3 happened in the interrogation center.
You told them that you had been asked to spy against the...
Of course. Why would I be afraid? I didn't have any plan to betray my people. My plan was to infiltrate the Shin Bet and destroy them from inside. Mm-hmm. So I had all the reasons in the world to go to the Hamas security wing and say, it's like, okay, I have like a good idea. Mm-hmm. Are you willing to help me? The answer was no. Why? Not because the Hamas security wing never spied on the Shin Bet or tried to. Because it's a very shameful thing. Because what if this type of news leaks to media? What's the position of Hamas leadership? it's a very shameful thing, so, and risky.
Shameful that they spied against the Shin Bet?
No, if I was caught by any chance as a son of a top Hamas leader, being in a relationship with the Israeli Shin Bet, while Hamas leaders are not willing even to sit on the table with the Israelis to negotiate humanitarian issues. Mm-hmm. So how come I sit down with them and drink coffee and talk about working together? So I was asked not to do anything, and this is why Hamas said after I released my book that we knew about him from the beginning. Not because they were smart, because I told them this. and more than this, I worked for the Israeli Shin Bet for 10 years, and I'm very proud of it. It was one of the best times of my life, because we could save lots of people's lives. Palestinians, Israelis, and Americans, and all type of people.
So why didn't they torture you in prison?
Because I was a son of top Hamas leader.
And so you were like a noble prince almost.
So we had also a problem with hypocrisy as well. Now, in front of, like, in that, during that time, I start to ask myself this question. What if Hamas, at some point, will form a government, and let's imagine that Israel is destroyed, and Israel is not on the map anymore, and Hamas is ruling our people. Are they going to deal with our people the same way that they're dealing in prison? In prison, they were mini-government. They had prime minister, they had the Shura Council, and this is what Hamas is doing today in Gaza Strip, 15 years after. It's all about intimidation and torturing people for what they call it, suspicions, that they have a relationship
with this. This sounds like the most dangerous days of Stalin in Russia, where millions of people lost their lives, and Stalin, nobody knew how many he killed till afterwards. This is almost the same. It's not based on religion in Russia. It was based on Stalin's insecurities and communism. But at the same time, he used government to stifle basic human freedoms.
Yes. It's a similar situation, but it's more complicated, because the propaganda is huge and the misunderstanding is bigger than anyone can imagine. Try to step into my shoes right now. I was in the heart of not only Hamas leadership, Fatah leadership, and 10 other Palestinian factions because of my father's relationship. Let me tell you how I worked, and I'm willing to donate some information. This is maybe for the first time. I isolated my father. I isolated him. I told him, you cannot trust anyone. You cannot contact anybody. I need to put you in a safe house. And I became his point of connection with every Palestinian faction. If somebody was calling from Yasser Arafat's office, it had to go through me. If somebody was calling from the Public Front for Liberating Palestine, it had to go through
me. And why did your father agree to this?
Because he trusted me, and because he still trusts me. And by the way, I was trustworthy, because he's still alive till this moment. In fact, he owes his life, and he has a moral responsibility that the Israeli Shin Bet knew about his location for years and years, and he's still alive, and they protected his life. And he owes them somehow his life. He needs to deal with this issue. Not only my father, Sheikh Jamal Tawil, we're talking about many other Hamas leaders that they should be dead by now.
So if the Israelis were concerned, leave your father out of the equation for a moment, because he was connected to you. Why did the Israelis not take out the other Hamas leaders?
Well, the goal was not to kill. The goal was not to kill. The goal was to stop violence. Sometimes, if you know about a military leader, you don't go and assassinate a politician. You assassinate the military leader that you cannot arrest in order to put pressure on the political leader to have them come to the negotiating table and talk. And the problem that the type of war that Israel was facing, that the Palestinians never got the chance to step into the shoes of Israel and think for a second, how hard is this? I ask my people, can you imagine early in the morning a suicide bomber blowing himself up in a bus or a taxi, people going to schools? Have you ever tried or like feel like this? Maybe you see Israeli troops coming in, but you never ask yourself, why did they come in? Why did they come in? Now what I'm trying to say, we come to this topic, but what I'm trying to say that during that time, we spied on everybody.
from the top leader, Yasser Arafat, to the smallest one. I was sitting in a room and was listening to everything, and we knew all the secrets. The personal life, the lies, and how much they care about my people. And this was the biggest shocking thing. It was not a brainwashing process from the Israeli Shin Bet to teach me how to hate my people and work against their will. It was discovering lies and lies and shocking truths about this entire conflict. That my Palestinian people, in fact, like people who are willing still to die for the cause of Palestine, if they get access to this type of information, they will rethink. So it was very shocking for me to learn all this information and facts through my enemies. I was not working for the Israeli Shin Bet as do this and do that. In fact, most of the information that came, it came from the Israeli Shin Bet, and I put the information together. I think the amount of information the Israeli Shin Bet gave me was much bigger than the information that I gave them. And every time, we were very careful, even on the life of a suicide bomber. 10 years of working with the Israeli Shin Bet, I am not responsible for the death of any person, Israeli or Palestinian. 10 years, not even one.
And how many lives did you save?
I don't know, because this is not my only effort. Mm-hmm. It was many efforts. We had all type of forces. And I pray for everybody who's working in the field today, because I know that their job is very tough. And yes, there were some racist people there. You know, they're everywhere. But there were people who cared about the life of my people.
Is there Palestinian
leaders? Let me give you an example. Please, this is very important.
Okay.
Once we had information about mastermind behind suicide bombers. And we located the car, everything, and he's supposed to be assassinated. 6 months he disappeared, we didn't see him, and it was the perfect shot. If he's alive, one more day, we are afraid that he's going to send another person. And that day, by chance, his child was in the car, and the entire operation was canceled. And this is, I'm witnessing this. This is not to brainwash me, and I'm not paid to say this. This is the reality that we lived. But at the same time, there were mistakes and there were many innocent people who were killed in other occasions. Sometimes an Israeli soldier in a tank, Merkava, and he's shooting a shell and killing lots of civilians by mistake. Or because somebody was showing off in a gun and they targeted him, in the same time there were school students walking by. So mistakes happen. This is a war. And all the time, I want from my people to understand that why is this happening? Why are we doing it anyway? For what cause?
How did you live every day in this tension? You're playing on two sides. You're protecting your father, who the way you describe him and the way you've spoken about him when we met the first time and the way you write him in the book, and the way you talk about him even now, you seem, in many ways, as a person maybe caught up in an ideology, but also a very noble kind of person.
Honestly, he's just a victim of his own God. And it's not more than that. Like, my father is among all men that I met in my life. You know, I met Christians, Muslims, fundamentalists, and moderate people. And there is no better example among men like him. And I love him, as I said, and I hope that one day he will stand for the truth, because I am sure that he knows the truth. And he knows that our people are going to self-destruction.
Do you have any contact or connection with him today?
Since the release of Son of Hamas, he disowned me, and I didn't talk to him since then. But hopefully that we will talk in the future. I believe that we will talk again, and we will meet again, and we will work together to bring our people peace. That is more important than peace with political borders.
How did you live with this inner tension every single day? You're talking to Yasser Arafat. You're talking to the leaders of the Palestinian Authority. You're dealing with the Israeli Shin Bet. You're protecting your father. It's like you're walking on a tightrope.
Well, it was not an easy life, and that was not even a choice that I had to make. As you see, I got involved with the Israeli Shin Bet for my people's agendas. It was not for a personal agenda or for the Shin Bet agendas. I found myself in a situation where everybody is lying to everybody, and people were dying on daily basis, And I had to make very difficult choices. When I knew about a suicide bomber, first of all, I cared about his life. Second, I cared about the life of innocent. Many Arabs were killed in Israel by Palestinian suicide bombers. And we are talking about what really matters, the life of a human being. It just, it's that simple. And when you are in a position like this, you have to make choices. Either you become a coward and you stick your head in the sand and you say, I didn't see anything, or you have to risk even your own life in order to save one human life. And this is the only fuel that I have. And I don't care if I have 1.5 billion Muslims who hate what I say today. What I care that we saved human lives. And this is what really mattered.
In the Palestinian schools today, controlled by the Palestinian Authority in the West Bank, is this culture of death continuing to be taught every day in this, underneath the what they're calling the moderate PLO?
Do you want bottom line or do you want...
Bottom line.
Okay. Bottom line. I said 2 or 3 years ago on Fox News that Islam is going to collapse in 10 years. People told me, what are you counting on? Simply, the walls of isolation are gone that everybody tried to build. And today people have access to information. Today people can go and Google everything and search and look for the truth if they are willing to look for the truth. Islam is not going to stand in front of this new information revolution. And it's going to be gone. And I think this is the main source of the hatred in the heart of Muslims who believe in the God of the Quran. Because from the first place, he does not like the Jews, even if they occupied the Palestinian territories or not. He doesn't like them. Muslims, they're different. Muslims, by the way, can coexist with the Jewish people easily. They can live, we can find them here in our events, and here in the United States, they're peaceful, they're not fighting and killing Jewish people. Because they have morals, it seems that they have morals more than their God.
Well, we have historical periods also. During Spain, in the 800s, 900s, we had an age of time which is called the Golden Age of Spain. I don't think it was necessarily golden, but nevertheless, Jews lived together in Muslim Spain in a beautiful way. Is that an aberration of history? Was that the Jews were saying, I mean, why did that happen at that period of time?
Well, Islam is a political religion. If I am weak, I don't have to fight you. If I am strong, I have the choice, either to fight you or enslave you. Mm-hmm. So this is the situation that during the history. So sometimes you see that there was coexistence, and sometimes there was not. What really matters, the behavior of the Prophet of Islam himself. I ask Muslims, did Muhammad himself kill Jews? Yes, he did. Did he launch campaign to cleanse them from the Arab Peninsula? Yes, he did. So if this is the highest example that you protest and you are willing to fight anybody who mentioned his name in a bad way, if this is your highest example, then why are you living in a denial, saying that this is not the real nature of Islam? It is the real nature of Islam. It's in the Quran. Go to chapter 9, verse 5, verse 25. It asks to kill the Jews, the Christians, wherever you find them.
Do religious Muslims hide this fact from us intentionally?
Muslims don't know the real nature of Islam.
Muslims don't know their religion. We are talking about 1.5 billion Muslims. 300 million only speak Arabic. Among the 300 million who speak Arabic, we have less than 5% who can understand the language of the Quran. It is not the street language. They read it, they chant it, they focus on the chanting rules without understanding the meaning. In fact, in order to understand the meaning of the Quran, you have to read many books to explain what this means and what that means, and the historical event that is related to that verse. How many Muslims pay this effort to understand their religion? I guarantee you that it is a very small percentage, and it's a minority. Muslims protect Islam because they want to protect their identity, and it's their right. They are a peaceful people. They're not terrorists in nature. But when they come and say that Islam is a religion of peace without understanding the real nature of Islam, they agree to stay in the captivity of Islam. And I think, and I believe, there are two main things. And by the way, we are done with the first one, and hopefully the second one will be done soon. To translate the Quran to the street language, we're just done with this one. That Muslims will read the Quran and they will understand it. It never happened before. This is the first time. In fact, we highlight all the mistakes, historical mistakes, hundreds of mistakes. And I ask Muslims, how come your God, the creator of the universe, make such mistakes in his book that you believe it's word by word from him? And it's not only one mistake. We're talking about hundreds of mistakes. So this is from one side. The second most important thing, to expose the real identity of Muhammad. Who Muhammad is? Muhammad, to Muslims, is only the creation of their imagination. They hear about him. They never get the chance to know his personality. And this is going to be the second step, to put Muhammad into a movie. I want to bring his face to Muslims. Based on the Islamic resources, not based on what I say. And this is the way to educate Muslims, first of all, about their prophet that they follow. They say, prophet, I ask them, what's his prophecy? A prophet has to have a prophecy. What's his prophecy? The guy died before he told his people the prophecy. It's not a joke. A miracle, all prophets performed miracles in front of thousands of people as a proof that they came from the Most High One, the creator of the universe. Muhammad does not have a miracle. In fact, he does. He flew on a donkey from Mecca to Jerusalem during the night, and there was no witnesses for this miracle. In fact, there was one. The donkey. Let's go try to find the donkey and investigate with him if the miracle happened. What we're trying to say here, that this is the time for Muslims to know the real nature of their Islam, instead of just like being zealous, and they are willing to kill, they're willing to do anything to protect the reputation of their prophet, that they never got the chance to know who he is. It's very similar to the situation of the Dark Ages, when Christians didn't know anything about the Bible. It was in Greek. They couldn't read it, they couldn't understand it. And today, Muslims are living in the Dark Ages. They don't have access to understand the real nature of their religion, and this is the time to expose it. I don't understand why Muslims, like Jesus, we have many movies about Jesus' life. Moses, all the prophets, all the important figures. But Muhammad, nobody can even draw a cartoon about him. Nobody can, like, put him in a movie. Why not? Why not? Why not to put Muhammad in a movie? I want to ask my, you know, we tell them this. Aisha says, Muhammad came to the neighborhood and took me from my arm to his bed. This is what she says in Sahih al-Bukhari. And I ask any Arab Muslim father, how you're going to feel if somebody comes, he's 52 or 54 years old, and take your 9 years old daughter and sleep with her under the name of marriage or whatever it is. How you're going to feel about this? This is why, maybe because they are not educated either. They're not educated about this thing, and they think it's blasphemy, but it's in the Muslim most trusted books. So I want to go to the Muslim trusted books and bring events like this and put it in a movie. Maybe it will move their emotions. Maybe they will become more sensitive to how difficult and ugly the truth is. I ask them, who is Safiya? Most Muslims don't know who Safiya is. Safiya is the wife of Muhammad, and she's from a Jewish background. She's not an Arab, she's not a Muslim, she's not even a Christian. She's from a Jewish background. Muhammad killed her entire tribe in Khaybar. Killed her husband Kinana. This is not my words. You can go and Google Safiya and Google what Sahih al-Bukhari says. Sahih al-Bukhari, the second most trusted book after the Quran. And you will find the exact narrative based on the Islamic, what Muslims say. He asked Kinana, the tribe leader, to give him the treasure. Kinana refused. There was no confrontation or a fight between the Jewish tribe and Muhammad. There was not. He killed him, he killed every man, and he enslaved every child and every woman. And that night, after he killed Kinana, he slept with his wife Safiya, the 17 years old Safiya. The same night, he killed her husband, he killed her uncle, and her entire tribe. This is in one of the most trusted Islamic books. The way it is, you can all go and let's say that I am maybe lying and I'm doing Israeli-American propaganda. So please to go to Google and see what it's available in English and it's available in Arabic for everybody. So if this is the real nature of Muhammad, none of the Muslims that I know in my life, even the terrorist ones, are willing to sleep with a child of 9 years old. Even the terrorist ones. So I ask, do you have morals more than your prophet? How come? But they have their own imagination of their prophet. And this is the time to expose the real identity of Muhammad. And then they have to make a choice. We follow a prophet like this, or we don't follow him.
You said that we're living in a time of Google. And that's going to change the way that people are going to look at Islam, going to look at themselves. So now we had the Google revolution, or I think it was better, the Facebook revolution. Somebody will probably say, because the guy who made Facebook was a Jewish guy, it was a Jewish plot. But Egypt is a... Is Egypt going to be a country where ideas are going to become open? Or is the Muslim Brotherhood going to take over?
Well, I don't care if the Muslim Brotherhood take over Egypt. Honestly, instead of sitting in offices and teaching people how to go and fight for the glory of Allah, let them get stuck in feeding Egyptian people who are hungry and take care of education. Maybe they get busy of doing something productive and take part of the society. I don't see any danger of the Muslim Brotherhood being in charge in Egypt, by the way. Why? Because the Muslim Brotherhood of Jordan has been controlling the Jordanian parliament for the last 20 years. And Jordan is an ally with the United States. The problem will start if they start to take over the army. And this is the difference between Hamas in Gaza Strip and the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt. First of all, the people who started this revolution, and I've been in touch with many of its leaders during the events in Egypt, they told me that the Muslim Brotherhood tried to take over by bringing blankets, food to the people, and thank God that people of Egypt are smarter than that. And I think that there is a new generation in Egypt and everywhere in the Arab countries who believe in liberty, who believe in the Western civilization values, and they are willing to accept these values and these freedoms that will make them into a better nation.
So you're not nervous that Egypt will abrogate the peace treaty with Israel? And could be, I mean, looking at the situation today, you've got
Hezbollah, and with all due respect, I think it's because of Israeli mistakes. I don't think Israel should have left southern Lebanon or Gaza. I mean, from my point of view, it created two security nightmares, one called Hamas and one called Hezbollah. And by the way, the people of the Palestinian people are suffering terribly underneath their rule. And if, God forbid, fundamentalist Islam takes over Egypt, then we can end up with a terrible confrontation with Iran looming over the border. Because last Friday, the army let one of the fundamentalists, imams, preach in the middle of Egypt.
Yeah, Sheikh Yusuf al-Kardawi.
Right, and it was on television. And now
this is the problem of religious leaders. You know, all the time it's easier for them to ride the wave. Why? Because they're coming with the authority of the highest authority of that society. Like Sheikh Yusuf al-Kardawi, when he stood there, you know, the Muslim Brotherhood did not start this revolution. You know who started this revolution? The person who founded the Facebook and Twitter. These are the ones who started the revolution.
So it was a Jewish plot.
It's like
social network.
Social networks, information, that people have access to information for the first time in the Middle East.
So Arab leaders are afraid of information.
They are afraid of information. Islam is afraid of information. And Islam cannot stand the truth. What I'm saying here...
So why is Islam growing in Europe, which is an open society, where there is information? And we see Islam is growing.
Well, because lots of people become religious, not only Muslims. I know about hundreds of thousands of people, converts, and we have statistics. And we have contacts with most of them, from Egypt, from Algeria, from the Palestinian territories, from Saudi Arabia, from everywhere, who convert to Christianity on daily basis. On daily basis. But they don't say that. Islam is like any other religion, is growing. But I guarantee you that Islam, for the next few years, it has huge challenges to face. And most importantly, that we need to expose the real nature of Islam. And instead of saying this is politically correct and this is politically incorrect, we need to just tell the truth the way it is.
Well, some people are afraid to have you speak. And to be honest, you know, we came here tonight, we went to metal detectors, and we got the guy standing here, and et cetera, et cetera. I guess in my synagogue, when he came in our shul, things were more sedate, but you're Belinda, nothing exciting happens. But the people are, let me tell you what happened in Yorba Linda last week. In our little town, a group called the Islamic Circle of North America organized a fundraiser. A guy called Abil Malik, who speaks at UCI, where we have a lot of problems with the excitement with the Muslim Student Union, and they disrupted the recent speech at Ambassador Oren, the Israeli ambassador tried to speak. They believe that freedom of speech is only one way. This is a guy who comes to UCI and he says he supports Hamas, he supports Islamic Jihad, he supports Jihad in the United States. And he was the keynote speaker at the fundraiser in the place they rented, the Yorba Linda Community Center. So about 500 local people, Christians and Jews, came to demonstrate in front of the community center. We didn't disrupt their right to speak, even though we were terribly hurt by the words of hatred that they have. And we confronted them and said, why do you believe in such crazy radical ideas? What do you think the reaction of the 300 people who walked in, many of them were religious Islamic women with the habib and the whole covering, and with children, to us standing outside with signs asking why do they deny that 9/11 was done by Al-Qaeda? Why are they people who believe in Hamas? How do you think they felt about Americans standing in front and saying, you have a right to speak here, but we disagree with your speech?
Well, because it's easier for these folks to blame on someone else. They don't want to be responsible for what Al-Qaeda did. And instead of facing the truth and the reality of it and stand and condemn it and fight it, they know that it's not by the authority of Bin Laden.
Do you think it was good for us to protest them? To say to them what you're saying is wrong and immoral?
Well, we don't want to reach a level, you know...
We don't want to do anything violent.
Of
we
confrontation.
Don't believe it. No.
By any chance. And please, like whenever you think about the Palestinian people, by the way, wonderful people, one of the best nations. And think about my family. Think about my mother, about my dad. My dad is on the top of a Hamas organization. And I guarantee you that he's a wonderful person. Like, most of our people, wonderful people, they want to live in peace, but they're being lied to. And this is the time to liberate them, first of all, not from the Israeli occupation. The biggest loser from this occupation is Israel. I tell Israel, what are you doing there? Just like, withdraw. Get out of there. I know this is, of course, for security reasons. It's a big problem after the experience of Gaza. But honestly, our people have much bigger problems than the state of Israel and the occupation and then America. We have issues, and we need to deal with these deep issues that regarding to our morals, to our ideologies, to our belief, entire belief system, and the false gods that we worship every day. These are the biggest enemies, that they intimidate us. I mean, as Middle Easterns, they let us live in fear, shame, guilt all the time. It's all versus God's grace, where you feel loved by the highest authority that you worship. There you feel intimidated all the time. And any move, even if you're making something right, you feel always, I don't want people to talk about me, because this would bring shame on you and your family. The main reason to write Son of Hamas, that, by the way, the Israeli Shin Bet didn't like the idea, of course, after it was published. America didn't like the idea. My people didn't like the idea. Many Israelis didn't like the idea.
These people like the idea.
You know, because it's published. The eve of release of Son of Hamas, everybody was against me, including the Christians who I share the same God with in the Middle East. They said he's Judas. He's not more than a traitor. This is how they describe him. And you know something? I am very proud of it. If people want to say, let them say whatever they want to say. That was the main reason to write Son of Hamas. In our country, if somebody is exposed that he is working for the enemies of Allah and the nation Israel, they bring shame on themselves and the entire family forever. I am not coming from any family. I'm coming from a very famous family, and my father is on the top leadership of Hamas. And I exposed myself. Why? By doing that, it was the biggest challenge of my life, by the way. I know that the enemies of our people, the enemy of shame, fear, and guilt. And I thought that by exposing myself, this is the real identity of who I am. Why are you mad if I say the truth? I'm sharing with you what I did for 10 years. And this is not a propaganda against the Palestinians from the Israelis or the Americans. In fact, for the first time, I meet with lots of people. They say, we never thought that you as Palestinians suffer like this. And people start to understand. I'm speaking and protecting the rights of my people, but not false political agendas that is taking my people to death.
But let me read you a couple questions from the audience, okay? I want to just say one thing.
Give me
you
the
know,
bad
I,
ones.
I, what? I'm giving the audience 1 second. I have my own strong opinions about Israel, but one of the things that I've learned from talking to Mosab, and this is the second time we're sitting and talking before we begin that long-term gig in Vegas, but seriously speaking, is that when I feel, when he tells me about the suffering of Palestinians, and I have a strong feeling that Jews should live in Judea Samaria, we probably disagree about a few things, that I feel the pain of that suffering by talking to you, and that's something that I need to learn about also, and that's something that I have gained from our interactions. So this is a very valuable conversation. So for a guy like me who's a bit of a right winger, that's very important. But let me just go for a few questions from the audience quickly. With Hamas in charge of the Palestinians, and or really even Fatah, how can we have any kind of peace agreement?
Well, this is a very difficult question.
I know we started off with easy ones.
Yeah. I think for the next years to come, we need to connect and communicate with the Palestinian people and show them that we are not the enemies that they think of. And this is the best way, you know, it's individual effort. Like today, Israelis and Palestinians can talk on Facebook
and they can be in the same communities and talk, dialogue, and try to understand each other. As you said, everybody has his own belief system. No, I believe that the Jewish nation has the right for Judea and Samaria. Mm-hmm. I believe in that, and this is a huge part of the problem. 3,000 years ago, the Palestinians were living on the coastal area, and David has his kingdom in the mountain area. Now today, the situation is upside down. Israelis live on the coastal area, and the Palestinians live on the mountain area. The ideological depth for the Israeli nation is in the mountains, where the Palestinians are asking for a state to be established. I personally don't support a Palestinian state, not because my people don't deserve freedom, because I believe that a state will bring only destruction to the region. It will bring only destruction to my people. Peace is not a state of political borders. It's a state of mind. My people are very tired. You know what I say? I might sound extreme now, but if Arabs give Israel all the human and natural resources and let them rule, they will become the most powerful nation in the world.
Okay, what made you discontinue your relationship with the Israeli intelligence? Why did you stop being a spy?
Well, that was a very difficult life, you know, for me as on the personal level. And while I was working with the Israeli Shin Bet, I was not working for the Israeli agendas anyway. We disagreed many times. We had our crazy conversations. We fought sometimes. We disagreed. And I was working with my conditions, let's say. Mm-hmm. I had only one goal. First of all, as a Christian, believer in Jesus Christ, as a God and Savior. And I hope that I don't offend anybody. I believe that everybody is God's children. And I saw the picture through the eyes of the Most High One, who cares about every one of his children. And for me, I knew that we were fighting a ghost. We were trying to defeat Hamas. Hamas is an idea. We cannot defeat an idea with a tank or a missile. We defeat an idea with another idea. There is like idea of hatred versus the idea of love. And unfortunately, that the idea of hatred has lots of raps and layers of lies that make it impossible to fight. And there is only one way, just to bring the truth. I know that I'm losing lots of opportunity because I'm saying this, because it's considered politically incorrect. By the way, not only Muslims are not happy with what I'm saying. Also, Jewish people, Christians, and everybody is emailing and calling. If Muslims see what Jewish people tell me to do to stop this campaign against Islam, they will be surprised. So why Muslims think that Jewish people and Christians are making this huge plan on a daily basis to destroy Islam? It seems that Jewish people and Christians are fighting, are protecting Islam somehow, more than Muslims in this country. Because what I say, it's considered politically incorrect, and everybody is trying to shut me down. And I'm saying, this is not a message to Americans against my people. This is a mission to liberate my people, because I know if my people are not liberated from their God that they worship every day five times, they will never be able to get out of this captivity. And I believe in this because I have been there.
I encountered this last week. Some Jewish students at UCI, where we've had all the conflict, are afraid to have you come to UCI because it might offend the Muslims on campus.
I'm telling you that I have experienced this. Jewish congressmen, you know, and very influential people who asked me.
Even more, you're speaking next week in Charleston, South Carolina.
The rabbi called me up from there. Yes.
He calls me up there. He says, doesn't know what to do. He says, how can I have this guy come? I was the first guy to bring him to a Jewish place, you know, so therefore, whatever. So, and then he got hanging around with Chabad, and we got 3 million Chabad centers. We can keep him real busy. But. He's not growing a beard. Don't worry about it. And we respect everybody's religious beliefs. We don't believe in, you know, in trying to encourage conversion. We believe everybody have their own religious beliefs. But he calls me up, he doesn't know what to do. Some says, you're gonna bring hatred to Charleston, South Carolina. There's people that are afraid of you.
Let me remind myself and all of us of President Ronald Reagan when he said in Berlin, the empire of evil. He said the empire of evil. In a cold war that two powers with mass destruction weapons could destroy Earth 7 times in a row. And everybody thought that this is the beginning of a war, but it was the beginning of the collapse of the evil empire, and it was the beginning of peace. We are waiting for people to stand for the truth today, not to keep stuck in our head in the sand. We will never be able to change our world to a better place, saying, okay, this will offend Muslims, and this will offend Jews, and this will offend... If you were doing something wrong, I will say it in your face. You know, but I don't see many Israeli suicide bombers, you know, coming in our towns.
No, Jews are a very self-critical group.
And
go to any synagogue, you'll find what the back row is saying about the rabbi.
And to be more honest, for the Israeli soldiers who carry operations in the Palestinian territories, I had the chance to meet with their mothers sometimes. Of course, their mothers didn't know who I was. But I had the chance to see the mother crying and telling the commander, you bring my child alive. I don't care about whatever you're doing over there. I just need my child alive. And next day, I see a Palestinian mother also crying after her son was arrested. I had the chance to see the picture from every corner and to see it through the eyes of Christian, Muslim, Israeli, Palestinian, Arab, and not to think in a selfish way. I understand everybody's frustration and point of views and where they're coming from because I lived it. I lived all of it. And I know and I relate to their sufferings. I relate to the sufferings of my people, but at the same time, I cannot forget the tears of mothers who lost their children in suicide bombing attacks. I cannot forget that. And today, I have a Muslim mother. I have a Jewish mother who adopted me. I have many Christian mothers. And I cannot just think like a Muslim. I rather to think like a human being who cares about all type of people.
You worked with Israeli intelligence for how many years?
10 years.
10 years. So one of the questions is what caused the breakdown? Why did you stop?
As I said, after 10 years, we were fighting a ghost. And I tell every government, we will never be able to defeat terrorism if we are not able to defeat its ideology. First of all, terrorists are victims. If we think that by chasing Bin Laden and a bunch of terrorists in Afghanistan mountains, this is how we're going to defeat terrorism, we are mistaken big time. One terrorist was in Ramallah town, a town of 25,000 people. We had all type of experience, technology resources, and human resources, and all type of forces. We knew how he looked like, and we couldn't find him for 7 years in a small town of 25,000 people. I hope that at some point we don't have to deal with this type of terrorism on the American soil that bleeds the government to death, and I hope this will never happen. In my opinion, this is much more dangerous than a mass destruction attack.
I have here really
but
two...
I didn't finish my answer.
I'm sorry.
But the best way in order to fight terrorism, we need to fight its ideology. We cannot validate what Muhammad says in our schools and our universities, you know, while dealing with Bin Laden. Bin Laden is like the street drug dealer. We need the main guy, the gangster. We need to get to him and put him in his place, expose his identity. This is the best thing that we can do, and this will guarantee stop of terrorism.
There's two very similar questions. How do you reconcile your Christian principles with being an informer for the secret police of the occupying forces?
I didn't understand the question.
Basically, Some Christians say you're betraying your principles as a Christian by working with the Israelis.
Well, this is why I'm telling you, like some people in the Middle East describe me as the Judas. But you know something? If you were in that situation, the person who wrote this letter, if you were in that situation and you knew about a suicide bomber that is going, heading to kill 20 innocent people, children, women, and all type of people, and you had only one shot to take the phone and inform the authorities to stop that, and you would be considered as a traitor by doing this, would you do it or not? I did it, and I am proud of it.
But a little while ago, Mohammed, I'm proud of it also. My son was one day in Jerusalem, and he was on the corner of King George and Yafo. And his friend was in Kikar Tzion, in Zion Square, and he calls him on the cell phone and says, let's meet at Zion Square next to the cafe, there's a cafe there a lot of tourists go to. And my friend says, I don't want to schlep down there, it's too far. He says, you know what, let's meet in the middle. So they met right in the middle, halfway between King George and Zion Square. And as they stood in the middle, a suicide bomber went out in Zion Square. And if my son had met his friend, he wouldn't be here tonight. So, shook him to his core. This is a little question out of the blue, but I think it's interesting. I don't know what your reaction is going to be. What's happening? What do you know? Or what can you tell us about Gilad Shalit? I don't know if this is a question you even can answer.
Well,
Gilad Shalit is the Israeli soldier that was kidnapped by Hamas and has been held already for close to 3 years in Gaza. Some of us saw the movie of him. It was about a year and a half ago.
5 years.
5 years. I'm sorry about the amount of time. And it's a real tragedy, and we pray that he'll be released. But what can you tell us about Gilad Shalit?
Well, you know, what's fascinating that my father is on the top list of the prisoners swap to bring Gilad Shalit home. Not because my father is the most dangerous prisoners that Israel cannot release, because, you know, his position, and they want to respect him, so they put his name, first name. But he's going to be released I think in 4 months, in June. What I'm saying here, that I think that Israel dealt with the situation with lots of wisdom. If they gave any price for Gilad Shalit, while I think it's very hard, you know, on his mother's heart, but to give any price is not acceptable. Because the terrorist that I told you about, that we spent 7 years to find, his name is Ibrahim Hamid. And this is one of 400 terrorists that Hamas want to release for Gilad Shalit, that they are responsible for the death of dozens of Israelis. And I believe that if they are released, they're not going to be only a threat against Israel. There will be a threat against the Palestinian Authority and the Palestinian people, because they are extremely, extremely dangerous. In fact, like Ibrahim Hamid, this guy, he was the Hamas security wing in prison chief. He was the one who's responsible for all the torture.
When you were there?
When I was in prison. And later on, he became the Kitaib al-Qassam Brigade head in the West Bank. So we're talking about somebody who does not even care about Palestinians, who doesn't care about Israelis. He just enjoy killing. And to release him somewhere to Damascus or wherever, even the West Bank, it's going to be a very bad decision for the security of everybody in the Middle East.
Who funds Hamas? Where's the money come from?
Well, the Muslim Brotherhood, which is, it's the same as Hamas, the Muslim Brotherhood, this is their strategy. In order to protect the mother, the big movement, they create a small movement for every conflict. So they wanted to fight Israel, and they learned from confronting with the Egyptian authorities in the 40s of the last century. So they said, we create Hamas, They asked my father and six other Hamas leaders come and establish Hamas. We share the same ideology. We believe in the same God. Go and destroy Israel. This is your goal. You don't tell us what you do. We will be your infrastructure. We will build schools for your children, charity committees. We will support you, support your fighters, support your families. But we are totally separated. This way, Israel fought for 20 years against Hamas only. And they never had evidence or enough evidence to fight against the Muslim Brotherhood. And the Muslim Brotherhood strategy here in the United States is the same, without mentioning groups. They have many groups working here on the American soil. Hamas and the Muslim Brotherhood are the same organization. The first principle that Hassan al-Banna, the founder of the Muslim Brotherhood, said everybody has to pay 5% or percentage of their annual income to the movement. And Hamas is the same thing. My father, a top leader, he pays from his own pocket. Except students and extremely poor members, they're not required to pay. So we are talking about a movement that even if they don't have funds and financial support, it can live and survive.
Mm-hmm. I've had a bunch of questions here, which I don't know much about this, but there's three or four cards asking this question, so I want to throw it at you. Okay. Tell us about the 12th Iman. What is this? And there's been a few things that this is Glenn Beck, which I'm not, I was talking about this. What is this 12th Iman business?
Well, this is a Shi'i issue. It's the second biggest Islamic denomination. They're waiting for the Mahdi. It's like the Messiah that you wrote. And the 12th one, so they believe that 11 already came, and the 12th one who is going to bring, who's going to establish the kingdom of Allah, which is similar to the kingdom of God to Christians and the Messiah in Judaism. So this is the 12th Imam. And they have been waiting for him for a long time now.
Is this a dangerous thing, this, the belief in the 12th? I mean, I've read in the media about Ahmadinejad, the 12th Iman. Is this something that we should be, we believe in Messiah, we believe Messiah is going to bring a period of goodness, kindness, holiness into the world, not conflict, death, and destruction. Is this something which is ominous, or this, what is the nature
of
this belief?
First of all, we should not be afraid of this because it does not exist.
Okay.
there is no 12th Imam coming.
Okay.
I promise. It doesn't exist, but it exists in people's minds. And this is where it becomes dangerous. Like the God of Islam, he does not exist. Like a God says that the sun sits in a well of mud, the end of Surah Al-Kahf. رَاهَا تَغِيبُ فِي عَيْنٍ حَمِئَةٍ means like a well of mud, regarding to the Islamic explanations. Now, this God does not exist at all, because a God doesn't know where the sun sits is not a God of the universe, but he exists in people's minds and people's hearts. And this is where we need to fight that. And the 12th Imam is the same story. It's a ideological warfare, and this is where we need to go.
Is there moderate Muslims?
Most Muslims are moderate people. The majority of Muslims are peaceful people. The majority. We need to know the difference between Islam as ideology, as it is in the Quran, and the behavior of Muhammad. This is something. Muslims are the followers. When we say followers, they are traditionally Muslims. They were born in that environment. They don't know anything about Islam. And I tell you that the majority of Muslims don't care about Muhammad and his stories. And they don't want even to follow or pay the price of killing themselves for the glory of that God. So the majority of Muslims are wonderful people. They are peaceful. And this is not a message of hatred. There are a couple of bridges of misunderstanding. I'm trying to remove them and build many bridges of understanding between all type of people.
But I understand something. If you get up in the Jewish world, and you speak something which is hateful and malicious and extreme, We have got so many Jewish organizations that are very busy. They got the aid. They all got alphabets names to them. There are a lot of them. We even got too many of them, but that's another conversation for another night. And they all get up and they scream Gewalt and they yell and the tumult and the whole Jewish world becomes very self-critical. Why do we not see moderate Muslims have the courage to stand up and confront what we've been talking about here tonight?
Well, first of all, because look at my situation. I am not asking everybody to go work for Israel to get validated or get a good certificate. It's not what I'm asking. But at least they need to get out of the captivity of shame. I had an Egyptian young man coming to me in Denver 2 weeks ago. And security, you know, it's like, I told him, please, you know, it's like, I love to talk to my people. I care about my people. And we sat down in the office and I asked him a few questions about Islam and if he really believes. I told him, you know, what's your problem? And be honest in your answer. I told him, you don't want to disappoint the heart of your parents. No Muslim wants to bring shame on himself and disappoint his people. Everybody is afraid of this weapon, shame. Everybody is ashamed. This is why I wrote Son of Hamas. If your biggest fear is shame, okay, I bring all this shame on myself and I still live in dignity. And I live for the truth no matter what. And there will be generations of Mus'ab in the Middle East. Even if I've got the worst reputation today, I care about our people there and they will believe in what I'm saying at some point.
Before Mosab came to me the first time, I called up Rabbi Brisky's and my mutual friend, Dennis Prager, and I said, Dennis, I got to do this interview, get a little kit, figured he'll give me a few hints. And he said to me, this is a courageous man, because he has the courage to stand up whenever very few people stand up. Mosab, do you find that any American Muslims from this more moderate element which you speak about are willing, even quietly or even overtly willing, to be supportive of you?
Yes, I receive lots of emails from Palestinians, from people from Muslim background, and we have been talking, and soon I'm thinking to launch a radio station to my town. I want to talk to them every morning. I said that I will be back soon. And it seems that I'm going to fulfill my promise by going back in a radio station. And I want to read the newspaper to them every day in the morning to communicate with them and talk to them and say, good morning, Ramallah, every day.
Good morning, Ramallah, instead of good morning, Vietnam. Okay, good morning, USA. Now I got we're getting to the end of the evening. This is not an offer for anybody, but if somebody wants to know, do you want to get married? What do you see as your future? You know, the old question, I've got a girl for you, but... I've got a nice Christian girl for you, it's okay. How do you see your future?
Well, I'm living my life normally. I'm not hiding, and I'm dedicated to work toward the goal of liberating my people. Not from the Israeli occupation, not from America, not from the Western civilization, from their own enemies. And this is what I give up a lot to do. And this is just the beginning of this journey. There are gonna be more books to come, and hopefully there will be movies also that I'm working on to educate them, communicate with them, and this will be my happiness. On the personal level, I rather to keep this for myself.
Ah. Send me an invitation. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank Rabbi Brisky for hosting us this evening. I want to thank Mosab for joining us again.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay.
God bless you, God bless America, God bless Israel.
Thank you so much, Mosab. Thank you, Rabbi Eliezeri. Thank you all so much for coming.